Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. What a great show we have for you. I'm a little nervous, frankly, because I have to talk to really smart people today, and I always get really nervous when I have to talk to smart people. Second hour, Mark Brumley, president of Ignatius Press, will be here. And I believe we will just do open forum with Mark. You can ask Mark whatever you want. It's always nice when Mark is on. And we have an author published by Ignatius Press, the first hour, and a conversation, frankly, I've been looking forward to. The book is called Women of the Church, What Every Catholic Should Know. It's from the Augustine Institute and Ignatius Press. And it's part of a series, What Every Catholic Should Know, that Ignatius Press has done. And a whole bunch of just wonderful books on various topics that Catholics should know. This one is by Bronwen, McShea, and that's what we're going to talk about today, is women in the church, or women of the church, I suppose I should say. You're welcome to call if you want to get in on the conversation, 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. In addition to this book, Women of the Church, What Every Catholic Should Know, Bronwen McShea is also the author of, La Duchesse. How'd I do on that, Bronwen?
Good. Pretty good. La Duchesse, yes.
Okay. La Duchesse. All right. Also, in addition to that, the author of Apostles of Empire. Bronwen McShea, thank you very much for being here with us.
My pleasure, Cy. Thank you for having me on the show.
You're also teaching now. You've taught in various places, but you're teaching now at the Augustine mm-hmm. Institute. You're mm-hmm. a visiting
yes.
professor there. Is that right?
Yes, so I teach mostly remotely, but I go on campus once in a while. So I'm based in New York, not Denver.
A lot of my college professors taught remotely, but they were in the class with us. They just taught remotely. Does that make any sense? I don't think that makes any sense. The number is 888-318-7884. I always like to start out with the hard-hitting questions. So why'd you write this book? Why'd you write Women of the Church?
Well, it grew out of two sources. So my second book, La Duchesse, which you mentioned, it's a biography of a French Catholic duchess named Marie de Vignerot. She was the niece of Cardinal Richelieu. And I kind of stumbled across her as a patroness of the Jesuit missions in New France when I was doing my first book. And I just started keeping a file on her. And I realized she was one of the most prominent Catholic leaders of the 17th century, and no one had ever heard of her. And the Pope knew
wonderful.
Her at the time. Everyone in Europe thought she was a very important leading Catholic figure.
But forgotten.
Because she was a duchess, she's forgotten for various reasons that I get into. And so that project, I wrote her biography, which took many years, but it was very rewarding. It got me more into the subject of the history of Catholic women generally. And so when I was asked to teach at the Augustine Institute several years ago, one of the teaching ideas that we had at the beginning was a course on the history of women in the church. And so the lectures for that course partly inspired this book idea. Once I was at the Augustine Institute, this book project kind of developed with them. So it grew out of these two sources, I would say.
And
my research.
Apostles of Empire was your first book then?
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
when you
yes.
say New
yes.
France, you mean mm-hmm. what we would kind of call Canada now.
Canada, although the French, New France, La Nouvelle France, as they would have said, actually encompassed, theoretically, the whole Great Lakes region.
Uh-huh.
And then eventually the Mississippi Valley, which then sort of splintered into, they broke into another province. So New France actually was more than just Canada. It was parts of what became the United States. And the French had extensive missions, Jesuits and other missionaries. And so that book grew out of my doctoral dissertation at Yale. So,
And that led you to La Duchesse. I'm trying so hard.
La Duchesse, very good.
Because I know you speak French, and it's humiliating to be a Californian trying to say these things. But
you're doing just fine. I have a family member who was reading the book and said, you know, it's a great book, but there's too many French names in it. So.
that's a problem with French history.
I've often thought there's too many French names in it. I'm used to this sort of thing.
Well, congratulations on the new book, Women of the Church. I think it's a wonderful addition to the series, but also just a wonderful addition to the reading possibilities that parents, I always mm-hmm. think, can parents put this in the hands of their kids, whether they're young kids or teenagers? If you've got a kid who will read, mm-hmm. I would mm-hmm. love to see this in the hands of a Catholic kid. Because in part because maybe there's a balancing effect here. Maybe the story of Christianity is not just Augustine to Aquinas, but there are some female names in there as well.
Sure. And I actually, when I wrote the book, I was envisioning maybe young adults, maybe teenagers. I dedicated the book in part to my young nieces. And one of my younger nieces, who's 9, 10 years old, was actually reading the book this week. So maybe, yeah. Maybe even younger girls than I think, and boys, could read this book. I think I'm hopeful that it will. I say in the introduction of the book, I wish I had known many of these stories when I was growing up Catholic. And so I wrote this in large measure because I wanted people in their earlier years to learn these stories so that you don't have to go to graduate school at Yale and work on several books in order to encounter some of these fascinating, important women in the church's history, which was my trajectory as a Catholic who went to graduate school.
Which was the harder problem for you, finding women to write about or deciding which women to leave out?
Deciding which to leave out was a challenge because partly this book is one in a series. I believe it has the most, it's the sort of fattest volume in the series. I was given a strict
really?
Word limit. I think so. It's if it's not the fattest, it's the second widest. So it could only be so long so that it would actually fit well with the series. And so I was given a word cap and of 60,000 words, which was a lot fewer words than I'm used to having writing big biographies and things. And it was tough. Even women that I wish I could have spent several paragraphs on or several pages, I sometimes had to put in a paragraph with one or two other figures because I wanted the book to include many important saints, also blesseds who are less well-known people on their way to possible canonization, but also to kind of reflect the great variety. And so I had to make some tough choices here and there about who to include and how long to include them.
Well, there are important women in the history of the church, just as there are important mm-hmm. men in the history of the church who mm-hmm. are not renowned for their sanctity, maybe, but are renowned for some mm-hmm. for their leadership in some other way, queens mm-hmm. Or mm-hmm. leaders of
yes.
other sorts. Isn't that right?
Yes, and that's one reason I titled this Women of the Church. This is not a typical Lives of the Saints book.
Yeah.
There are many saints, very saintly figures throughout. But I'm a historian. I was asked to write this as a historian for a series called What Every Catholic Should Know. And so I'm thinking, which women in the history of the church should every Catholic know? And I think figures like Isabella of Spain, you know, who started the Spanish Inquisition,
yeah.
or Maria Theresa of Austria, one of the most powerful imperial figures in European history. They were Catholic women. They
right.
they were a mix of pious and not so saintly sometimes.
Sure.
And so I included figures like that.
Isabella of Spain did start the mm-hmm. Inquisition, but she's also famous for something mm-hmm. else. Like, can we give her credit for one other thing? Like, didn't she send somebody on a trip?
Yes, she was responsible for Christopher Columbus's
okay.
voyages. And also, and I get into it a bit. I don't want to, you know, give everything away.
Yeah.
She helped, the church had some kind of moral laxity in the monasteries. So she worked with Cardinal Jimenez de Cisneros. As kind of she helped reform some of the monastic institutions in Spain. So she did some good things too.
Bronwen McShea is our guest. She's a historian, and she's written a lovely book on Women of the Church, What Every Catholic Should Know, part of the What Every Catholic Should Know series from Ignatius Press. And actually, we have Mark Brumley, the president of Ignatius Press, on regularly, and I always ask him when he comes on, recommend a book. And he was so enthusiastic last time, holding up this book. And I said to him, I think Bronwen McShea is the best author's name I've ever heard. You have to be a writer if your name is, that's a writer's name right there, Bronwen McShea. You were born to it.
I appreciate that. I can't take credit for it because my parents are the ones who decided on this.
Yeah.
It is funny because when I first started writing, I have the problem that some people don't always know if Bronwen is a female name or male name.
Yes.
So when I was younger, I always used my middle name of Catherine. But Bronwen Catherine McShea sounded a little too,
Irish?
Don't know. A little too long and too self-important. So I like the Yeah, I credit my parents for choosing a good name for me.
Yeah.
So thank
yeah,
you.
Yeah. Well, let me ask you, because in the introduction to the book, you talk about a woman who is a saint, but in addition to being a saint, also an extraordinary leader, which is a different quality than sanctity. Not all saints are great leaders. Not all great leaders are saints, but Claire of Assisi. And several times you use the word ordinary to talk about Claire. What is it about... What is it that drew you to Claire, and what do you mean by that word ordinary?
Right. In the intro, I use the word ordinary specifically in connection to I visited Assisi back in 2015, and I was given a tour of the convent of San Damiano, and I was, you know, brought to the table and the benches where she and her sisters would have meals, and also this kind of stone area where they would do laundry. And I was very, very struck by the ordinariness of the surroundings. I mean, it was a beautiful monastery, one of the most beautiful settings in our Christian, that's out there. But just the kind of the ordinariness of sort of the everyday activities that this saint, that was sort of a giant in my mind, she was one of the few saints I knew about growing up. I'd seen the movie Brother, Son, Sister, Moon that my parents showed me. And so Claire was sort of a kind of larger than life figure in some ways to me. And so to be around where she and her sisters did laundry and ate, and to sit on the same places and walk, it really, the humanity of Claire and her sisters really hit me in Assisi in a way that I don't think would have happened had I not visited there.
Is that kind of the historian's vocation in a way to these people? I mean, there's these people that we know their names, like Claire is one of them. Mm-hmm. Like you, this is just one of the most almost like the name doesn't relate to a person. It just relates to an idea, this, you know, that's bigger than any one person. And so the historian maybe has the vocation of reintroducing us to the person, not just the idea.
Yeah, and I think with in the Catholic world, where we have people who are canonized as saints and honored in special ways, sometimes for many centuries, and so we have all these kind of iconic moments in their life that we emphasize, or ways of talking about them.
Yeah.
In venerating them, that can happen like 10 times over compared to some historical figures with saints. And so part of my job, I feel, as a Catholic who is a historian, is to kind of show saintly figures, and sometimes less saintly, who are important in the history of the church, in kind of real time, in their everyday circumstances, their political context, their social context. So you sort of see, you know, some of the more iconic moments in context, and you realize it's difficult to be a saint. It's never easy to be a saint. And when you see them in their times, I think they become more relatable, even the ones that are very larger than life.
Right. They're not just the painting of the girl getting her hair cut off. Here's a full human being who had to wash her laundry, for example.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Bronwen.
Yeah, or tell other sisters to do the laundry. or to tell others to do the laundry. Yep, she's an abbess.
That's true. Women of the Church is Bronwen McShea's latest book, What Every Catholic Should Know. Women of the Church in the What Every Catholic Should Know series from Ignatius Press. It's a heck of a name to live up to if you're a writer, because it sounds like the greatest writer in the world, Bronwen McShea. Well, she does a pretty good job living up to it. We'll talk more about the book when we come back. You are welcome to call with your questions, 888-318-7884.
Hang on. Catholic Answers Live will return in a moment.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite monks of Wyoming. Delicious mystic monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All mystic monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase mystic monk coffee, visit mysticmonkcoffee.com. That's mysticmonkcoffee.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
EWTN, teaching the truth.
Thank you so much for all that you do, and your mother Angelica and her words. I'll never forget the first shows on television when I found her, and that led me to the radio station.
I'm an 8-year homeschooling mom. I'm a veteran of doing this for a long time. What encouraged me was this beautiful nun named Mother Angelica, and one day she said, well, if you don't like the school, why don't you just pull them out and homeschool them?
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Did you know everything in our online store at shop.catholic.com is on sale? Books, digital products, online courses, gift items, and more. We've got it. We've even got Bronwen McShea's new book, Women of the Church, in there. You can go there and buy that right now. Hundreds of items on sale at shop.catholic.com. Hundreds of items, including Women of the Church, What Every Catholic Should Know from Ignatius Press, written by our guest, Bronwen McShea. Thank you again for being here with us. I appreciate that. And delighted to get to talk about Women of the Church. And I'm going to let me just throw this out there. I think there is a prejudice against the Catholic faith sometimes that it's anti-woman or that it's detrimental to women. Can you just talk a little bit about what you think about that idea and go ahead.
I would say one reason a lot of the stories I didn't know in this book was because some of the, like earlier on in my education, I went to public schools and secular institutions for my education. So early on, many of the accounts of the history of women in Western civilization or European countries or in Catholic world, as we might be more interested in, really painted pictures of conflict between men and women, maybe nuns getting sort of never being able to do what they really want to. So that there's sort of strains in certain lines of scholarship in women's history with sort of a feminist bent of certain kinds that like to underscore conflict between men and women, at least traditionally. And so stories of collaboration. I dealt with this issue even in my first book, looking at the Jesuits and New France, because some of the scholarship on the missionaries, whenever it came to Native American women or the French, some of the French women who came over to New France, were some of the existing scholarship underscored conflict between the missionaries and women, whether French or indigenous. And when I was looking at the sources, I just found so many examples also. I mean, there are examples of conflict, but there's many examples of collaboration with Catholic nuns, with Native American women who converted to Catholicism and were assisting with the mission and were kind of partners with the missionaries, not just being told what to do or in conflict with them. So this whole issue of both women's collaboration in a positive sense with the clergy and the laity more broadly, their collaboration with the clergy in mission settings was one of the topics that I wanted to contribute to in a scholarly way. And that theme has sort of carried through my other work. And so, I just think it's just hard to, a lot, there's sort of broad brushstroke caricatures of the Catholic Church when it comes to women.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, even some of our church leaders kind of echo that in trying to make up for what they perceive to be the world's criticism of the church. And so we sometimes accidentally reinforce that own perception of our own history while trying to correct it. And so with this book, I show plenty of examples of conflict and difficulties various saintly women had, sometimes coming from churchmen. But there are numerous examples also of people working together and the complementarity of men and women and laity and clergy as well. And and friendships between male and female saints and all that. So,
It does sound like history is full, and Catholic history therefore is full of injustices towards women, abuse of women, all of that. But and so we don't want to pretend like that's not there, that's not in the history.
Right.
But there's another narrative that's also there. And it's a story of great women doing great things because of their relationship with Jesus Christ. Like, this is at the center of what you write. I mean, I again and again, I see that it's the person of Jesus who's making the primary difference here in the lives of the men and women you're talking about in this book.
Yeah, I think there are certainly cases where, I mean, one of the most famous would be Saint Teresa of Avila. She begins to have mystical visions and encounters with Christ, encouraging her reform of the Carmelites. And she met some real resistance among some Catholic leaders in Spain. She eventually gets a lot of assistance from some churchmen and the King of Spain in particular, and the Carmelite authorities in Rome as opposed to Spain. So she does find friends to assist her, but it's really, there are many moments of conflict in her life. Her writings were suppressed in her lifetime. And I think it's her fundamental relationship with Christ that she encounters some of the time in this mystical relationship that is really the key to understanding her moments of courage and leadership, despite a lot of challenges that she's dealing with, including sometimes poor health. And so, yeah, I think the mystics show this very strongly, but it's at work in other people's lives as well.
Is it at work in the history of the church? So when you look at the kind of I don't know if history has progress. I don't want to get into that debate. I don't know, but you see the process anyways of, you know, the church moving through time. The Christ himself is a radical departure in his relationship with women from and in his teaching about men and women. Does the church immediately just live up to all the promise in Christ's teaching as far as that goes? Or is this an unfolding thing over time?
I would say no, it doesn't immediately live up to it. I think I draw from the work of some other scholars in sort of painting pictures of this. I have footnotes, you know, for different parts of the book where I'm not an expert. And the early church is one area where I'm not, that's not where my training is. But I think certainly when it came to Christ's interactions with some women that caused scandal among sometimes even his own disciples. And then also the Christian view of marriage as a coming together of two equal parties consenting. This was highly radical. Yes. And this develops in early Christian writing. And also the idea connected to that, and I'm drawing from other scholars for this. There was actually, people might think, because some of the critique that modern feminism has against Christianity is that it burdens women with this idea of purity too much in a way it doesn't burden men with. But ironically, in the ancient world, more people in some ways thought it was more possible for men to live a kind of monastic virginal existence than women. They thought women were sort of more animalistic and more incapable of maybe consecrating virginity in a way. I mean, there were certainly vestal virgins and things like that, but the bias was actually against women kind of offering themselves as sort of pure offerings as virgins. And so that also brings in a kind of radical egalitarian idea that both men and women are either called to marriage or to some sort of more radical existence with purity at the heart of that. And so it takes a long time. I mean, some of the very church fathers who promote some of these ideas in ways that are kind of radical for their time sometimes also will say things about women that don't sound too great if you're a woman reading them. So it's sort of a question of you know, Christ reveals difficult truths of all kinds, and the church's story in history is the story of people trying to follow Christ, not always succeeding, and trying to collectively more and more kind of honor the teachings that are given by Christ to the apostles.
Probably some of the hardest things to remove are the assumptions that we have that are often that we accept uncritically. And so you have, it seems like what I get reading Women of the Church, What Every Catholic Should Know, your new book, you see beautiful friendships between men and women, even in the ancient church. You see these really important women like the early martyrs, certainly like the mother of Jesus herself. But you also see it's taking a while. It's centuries for it to fully challenge the assumptions that everybody has about what a man is, about what a woman is, about how we're supposed to relate to one another.
Right, it does. And there's kind of history is not that linear. It goes up and down, and there's problems. And what, to me, as an early modern historian, one of the things that most fascinates me is the revolutionary moment in France and other countries. Before the revolutionary period, before there's sort of democracy spreading around the world, there was room for certain powerful women if they came from certain aristocratic families. There was some marriage laws that were in favor of women having property if it came from their paternal families. After the revolutionary period, when democracy starts kind of coming everywhere, there's actually this strong movement in favor of men dominating women.
Whoa.
In the 19th century.
What an interesting thing. All right, Bronwen McShea here to tell us how democracy ruined everything. We'll get back to that. When the resurrected Jesus appeared to disciples on the road to Emmaus, they didn't recognize him until the breaking of the bread. The same is true today. In the Holy Eucharist, we really meet Jesus. In The Eucharist is Really Jesus, author Joe Heschmeyer explains how knowing Jesus in the Eucharist is the key to understanding all of Christian faith. Order your copy of The Eucharist is Really Jesus today at shop.catholic.com or get it at a good Catholic bookstore.
Our Lord needs articulate defenders of the truth to spread the joy of the Catholic faith. Catholic Answers Monthly Giving Club, Society 315, helps you fulfill the call in 1 Peter 3:15 to always be prepared to make a defense for the hope that is in you. For as little as $10 a month, you'll help Catholics grow in faith, bring lapsed Catholics home, and lead non-Catholics to the truth. Go to casociety315.com and join today.
As we read the Gospels, every Christian faces the question again and again, what does Jesus mean? Getting the answer right is critical to both growth in holiness and fruitful evangelization. Want to know Jesus better so you can introduce him to your friends? Then it's time to get serious about understanding his words. Why not join Catholic Answers for our 10th annual Apologetics Conference? Learn from me the parables, sermons, and conversations of Jesus Christ, September 26th through 29th, right here in sunny San Diego. Learn from our guests, Dr. Scott Hahn and Kimberly Hahn, Dr. Ray Guarendi, Father Sebastian Walsh, Billy Junker, Father Paul Check, and, of course, all of your favorite Catholic Answers apologists. It'll be 4 days of fun, faith, fellowship, and a live radio show. Seats are still available, but going fast, visit CatholicAnswersConference.com or call 1-888-291-8000 today.
Conversation about God's truth along with guests and your calls. I'm Deacon Harold Burke-Sivers, and I invite you to join me tomorrow for Beacon of Truth on most of these EWTN stations. Now back to Catholic Answers Live with Cy Kellett.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. We're talking about the new book, Women of the Church, What Every Catholic Should Know, from Bronwen McShea. It's published by the Augustine Institute, where Dr. McShea is visiting, is that right? Visiting professor, yep, and by mm-hmm. Ignatius mm-hmm. Press. A wonderful book, I feel like you could put this in the, I don't know why this is my bias, because anybody could read this and profit from it, but I feel like you could put mm-hmm. this in the hands of a young person and it will mm-hmm. be formative for them. They will see possibilities for what it means to be Catholic that they didn't see before.
I mean, I'm hopeful that's the case. The sort of verdict's out, you know, what age can read the book and sort of grasp it. But I think there's such a variety of stories, religious vocations, different vocations that, I'm hopeful that will be the case, whether, you know, parents reading the book and teaching their kids about some of the stories or kids reading it directly. I hope so.
But I, well, you see, you and I might have two different ideas about young people. For me, anybody under 30 is a young person. So,
okay.
That's what I was talking about.
I was thinking of my nieces.
I wasn't talking about 8 year olds, but are those precocious 8 year olds. But one of the things I liked, and I take the warning not to romanticize the past to heart, but I liked the stories of, especially in the ancient world, of, of men and women who were friends in the church. Mm-hmm. And I feel like Christianity affords an ability or gives an opportunity for friendship between men and women that is very hard to have separated from Christianity. And I was thinking about, I'm thinking about as I say that, St. Jerome, who is mostly known as the most irascible saint ever. Like he's known for being in a constant bad mood. That's what people know him for. But these holy women are his close friends who he relies upon, and also says how Marcella is how you would pronounce the name. How she's so brilliant that if he actually told the truth about how brilliant she was, other men wouldn't believe him. You know, it's a beautiful thing. These kinds of holy friendships.
Yeah, and some of my own friends are irascible sometimes. So appreciated Jerome. I always appreciated Saint Jerome, a sort of curmudgeon saint. But yes, Marcella of Rome, Marcella actually is how you pronounce it. He said that she was she knew the scriptures better than almost anyone. And when he would travel, he would encourage, you know, if you have a question, ask her. You know, in my absence, how to interpret this or that teaching, you know. And so there are various examples like this in the early church and later on of important holy friendships.
So tell me about some of the modern women, and again, modern, I mean, sometimes we think modern is anything that came after Kanye, but I mean modern in the sense of the last 500 years, you know, anything that came since the Reformation. What has the role of women been in this very turbulent half millennium for the Catholic Church?
Well, there are maybe two general strains I would point to. I mean, I speak to more than that in the book, but both during the Reformation period, also during the Revolutionary period, when there were attacks on ecclesiastical institutions, monasteries, convents, Catholic women, nuns and convents, or even sometimes ordinary Catholic lay women, really showed a lot of courage in these moments, in Reformation England, for example, or in Revolutionary France, kind of standing up against the authorities, hiding priests, making sure mass took place in their homes, and sometimes facing the law, and in a few cases being martyred for their courage. And in the case of the French Revolution, and I'm drawing from other scholars who've worked on this more closely than I have, the Reign of Terror period in the French Revolution is seen as partly coming to an end because the resistance of ordinary Catholic people around France, including women, was so strong to some of the anti-Christian activity going on that it sort of helped put the brakes on the most radical aspects of the French Revolution. So and then the second thing, it actually really hit me. I mean, I had a strong appreciation for this going into this book, but it really hit me writing the narrative how crucial Catholic women, especially consecrated women in the 19th century, were to building up schools for poor students, boys and girls, hospitals for people who couldn't necessarily afford the best medical care, various ministries to the poor, you know, places to provide young working class women or children with kind of safe places to be and to learn some skills, you know, in a time when families are breaking apart due to migration because of the Industrial Revolution, like the social charitable infrastructure that we associate more and more in modern times with the government. Women, actually, Catholic women were tremendously important to building up institutions, often without much government support in the 19th century. And the legacy of that it's just staggering when you see it in the history. And so I gained a new appreciation of the history of consecrated women, more of an appreciation than I even had before I wrote this book.
That's an extraordinary point, because it's so often if you hear that, tell us about the history of the Catholic Church in the 19th century. Well, you're going to get, Pope Pius, the various Pope Piuses and Pope Leo and all that. Mm-hmm. But it's thousands and thousands of women founding churches and hospitals is probably the primary work of the Catholic Church in the 19th century.
Yeah, and men too. The proportion of religious actually went in favor of women in the 19th century for the first time in history. It was like, I think something like 60-40 women to men. So it was another historian I quote, Darmid McCullough, said at some point that it's like the face of the church became more feminine because of this new balance, the gender balance of religious who are out in the streets or out in hospitals. And so there are stories of collaboration too and partnerships that I show, but the 19th century was really a time when Catholic women came into their own in certain new ways, partly because of changes in education of women, formal schooling for girls. This starts to translate into different types of activities within the church and beyond.
Are there any of these 19th century women that you felt yourself particularly drawn to that you thought, wow, she's really something? I guess you have to tell each of their stories. Is there one whose story you just particularly got caught up in yourself?
I there were so many of them that I cared about. Actually, if I could mention, there's several different people. Mother Mary Lang. There were African American consecrated women in the young United States that faced difficulty, like discrimination, even from Catholic religious orders they wanted to be part of. So there were some pioneering African American religious women that really hit me at learning their stories and just integrating that into the narrative. And so they stand out.
Were they orders of African American women, or were they orders of
there
women?
There were several, and I'm blanking on the names because I don't want to get things wrong in the middle of the interview. But there were new institutes that were started by African-American women, sometimes because they were not permitted to join existing congregations. And so there's a historian.
An extraordinary thing, though, to in a certain sense be rejected by the church, because there was certainly a segregation in the United States, not necessarily everywhere in the church, but in the 19th century in the United States, African-American Catholic is at a disadvantage twice, inside the church and outside the church. And here's women founding orders to take care of orphans or to teach children or found a hospital.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and there's a scholar I cite for some of the material that I integrated, Shannon D. Williams. She's written about this much more extensively. So they stand out to me. Some of the early the women involved in founding missionary organizations, like Saint Emily de Villar, she lived in the early 19th century. She was French. She just decided to found a missionary congregation that would go to North Africa and parts of the Ottoman Empire, and they were opening hospitals and ministries in North Africa at a time when women were not doing mission work very, very much yet.
So they were blazing the trail.
Do this.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so people like Mother Cabrini kind of have examples like this before them when she begins her congregation too. So
we're talking about women of the church. If you've got questions about that, whether you're Catholic or not, you are welcome to call with your question. Bronwen McShea is our guest. Women of the Church, What Every Catholic Should Know is the book. It's out now from the Ignatius Press. 888-318-7884 is the number. 888-318-7884. I'm going to take a quick break and we'll come back and talk about the 20th century. 888-318-7884.
Hang on. We'll be right back with more Catholic Answers Live.
The Catechism defines evangelization as the proclamation of Christ and his gospel by word and the testimony of life. But what does that look like in real life? It looks like St. Paul street evangelists out in the public square sharing the good news, We're a Catholic nonprofit that starts conversations by handing out free sacramentals. Then we employ our method of listen, befriend, proclaim, and invite. Catholic Answers is supported in part by St. Paul Street Evangelization. Visit streetevangelization.com to learn more.
Each weekday, we'll dive into the timeless teachings of our Catholic faith, drawing upon the wisdom of the ages to navigate the challenges of today. Together, we'll seek truth, find inspiration, and forge a deeper connection with God. I'm Deacon Harold Burke Sivers, and I invite you to join me for Beacon of Truth, tomorrow at 4 p.m. Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. We're talking about women of the church. You are welcome to call with your questions, 888-318-7884. I got so caught up in the conversation, I forgot to give out the phone number for like 15 minutes there. I apologize for that, but I can see the lines are all filling up now. I apologize. I didn't give out the number for a little bit. Some of the American women that we know the names of, but maybe they, mm-hmm. like Catherine Drexel, for example. Mm-hmm. Tell us a little bit about Catherine Drexel. Maybe people don't know about her anymore.
Yeah, she was a Philadelphia heiress from a very wealthy family. She and her two sisters inherited a lot of money from their father, and she established a new congregation that was dedicated to the education of Black children and Native American children. And this was not something that girls from elite families in Philadelphia were supposed to be doing.
Really?
So this was kind of a radical decision. So, and she was apparently, partly because she was so rich, she was seen as one of the most eligible bachelorettes on the marriage market, and she decided to become a nun and do this instead. And so her legacy is rather dramatic in that regard. So eventually starting institutions all over the country.
And what do you make of that, I mean, even into the ancient world, but mostly, I guess, if I'm reading the book right, mostly starting in the medieval period, women lead institutions within the Catholic Church. They lead mm-hmm. giant monasteries or movements mm-hmm. or institutes or hospitals or all that starting in the medieval period. Maybe that's a story people don't know.
Yeah, I think some of the early abbesses, I mean, their powers change as you get later in the Middle Ages, but some of the early abbesses had similar territorial governance powers that some bishops had in terms of they would actually be in charge of several communities, sometimes male communities under their authority. So in medieval period, it's kind of a patchwork. Bishops didn't govern all institutions in their territory. Sometimes abbots and abbesses did as well alongside them.
Certainly during the world wars, maybe I'll just leave it to you to say what you'd like to say about mm-hmm. Edith Stein, but I'll just leave that. I mean, she's a Jewish woman, a convert to the Catholic mm-hmm. faith, a Carmelite, one of the world's great philosophers, and mm-hmm. murdered by the Nazis.
Yeah, and she was all, in some ways, even before all that happened, she was one of the first women to get a doctorate in philosophy in her setting. So she was kind of a bit of a trailblazer during a time when more women were going into higher education. She's a obviously remarkable figure. Not everyone knows her sister, Rose, also died with her at Auschwitz and was also a convert. So.
And are they killed because they're Jewish? Are they killed because they're nuns?
Yes.
Are they what brings
yes.
Edith Stein and her sister Rose to be killed by the Nazis?
They were taken because they were Jewish, and the Carmelites knew she was moved to the Netherlands to try to protect her because of her Jewish ancestry during her life, and then when the Nazis had more control in the Netherlands, she gets taken away, and it's very quick between the day she's taken and the day she's killed. It's truly terrible. So,
and then in Poland, I guess about the same time, Faustina Kowalska. I mean, God just doesn't stop, does he? He just keeps calling extraordinary women in her lifetime, you wouldn't say this is one of the most important people in history, but now we've got Divine Mercy Sunday. We just, you know, she's one of the most important figures in the modern Catholic Church.
Right, and she kind of, she emerges in this context where some of the most, you know, world-altering activities are happening, kind of the scene of, like, on the eve of World War II. So I present her in the context of this dramatically changing world that the world wars are part of. And, it was initially a challenge to me. How do I write about some of the great saints that stayed in monasteries, like most of their convents, most of their lives, and are not out there? Because I'm a historian, I like seeing people moving around and doing things more actively.
Have a
right?
war. Overthrow a government. But it makes it easier on the historians.
You know, when I actually got caught up in the details of her life, she's a fascinating figure, how she even became a nun and all that. So it ended up being, the challenge ended up being to, you know, keep the part about Faustina to the right number of paragraphs and not write too long about her. So we're talking
about the women of the church by the author of Women of the Church, or with the author of Women of the Church, Bronwen McShea. We'll go to the phones. We'll give you a chance to ask your questions. The number is 888-318-7884. We'll start with Walt in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, the home of Catherine Drexel. Walt, we're awful glad you're here. Go ahead with your question for Dr. McShea.
That's right. Catherine Drexel's from this area and greatly celebrate her feast day on March 3rd. Great lady. Did you, in your research, find any of these extraordinary women wanting to excise the word man from the Mass or emasculate the Heavenly Father or decide they wanted to be priests?
No, I not the ones. No,
I thought you were just going to leave it there. No,
not. I mean, not the ones that interested me and that I felt every Catholic should know. So I did not encounter much of that. So I kind of have a natural bias against people who want to alter the faith as Christ handed it down to us. So anyway, I think. The question of women's ordination it gets in the way of just looking closely at the tremendous variety of contributions women have given to the church from the beginning
I'm going to come back to you, Walt, and let you follow up. But it does put me in the mind of that doesn't mean that these are tame women. It means that they're fully committed Catholic women. But there's rebels in here. There's Dorothy Day in here.
Yeah, there's Dorothy Day. There's also lay women like the Duchess of Aguillon, who I wrote a whole book about, who tell great saints like Vincent de Paul what to do and make their ministries possible because of their connections and some of the great lay women that I present in the book, they're not docile. They sometimes kind of get things happening, and churchmen, including bishops, have to listen to them at times and are told what to do by them.
Scared of Mother Teresa.
Yeah.
I mean, they were, they were nervous around her. Like, what's she going to say?
I would be too. I think she's a remarkable figure.
Walt, you got a follow up? Are you good?
No, that was it. I just kind of a snarky question, but it annoys me that there's such an emphasis in modern times that we have to follow the zeitgeist and praise God. The church tradition does not follow the zeitgeist. God bless you.
No, thank you. Thank you, Walt. Thanks very much. The zeitgeist being, I guess, the spirit of the world, and that is the spirit we contend with. But these are also not women who are enemies of the world. I mean, they're not looking for a culture war kind of thing. I don't know how to describe it, but maybe you could describe it. You're the historian, but the through line of it is fidelity to Christ. Is that right?
Yeah, and in some cases that puts them at odds with, you know, figures in authority in the church who are not honoring Christ as much as they could be. And sometimes it makes them work very fruitfully with male saints and male blesseds and others who are following Christ. So it's not an either or. There's plenty of cases of the same figure dealing with faithful men and unfaithful men in their life that they have to kind of work alongside. And so, yeah. And there's stories also of women being not as faithful as they could be that sure. are disappointing in the end. So, there's more, I guess we could say about that, but I don't know if there's, you know, another question or another caller.
Thank you, Walt. I want to ask you about this then, though. Are all the women passed on now? They've all that are in the book, or are there any living women that made it into the book?
You know what? I think I tried to restrict it to those who had died, and so
because you never know what the living will do. You know, you might put them in the book, and then they mess up on you, and then you got to go back and take them out.
Yeah, and I also partly because I am a historian, like even writing about the 20th century so confidently is out of my comfort zone.
Yeah.
So. You know, I do make a comment at the end, you know, some of the women reading this book might be among those women of the church who we remember, you know, down the road. But I tried to kind of limit myself to those whose stories we have records of now.
The book is called Women of the Church, What Every Catholic Should Know. It's by our guest, Bronwen McShea. It's from Augustine Institute and Ignatius Press. You can get it now wherever you are. There is a kind of... almost like a camera of history, you know, that these are the things that we pay attention to, whatever falls within this camera shot, you know, that's mm-hmm. what we call history, and whatever's not in that camera shot, we don't know about. Was part of your motivation to move the camera just enough so that we didn't leave women out of the Catholic story?
Yeah, I think sometimes, and in very well-meaning ways, sometimes the women's history, the history of women, whether in the church or in other contexts, it often comes across as kind of a side discipline, like another topic of history, as opposed to what I want to do is kind of make sure people know these stories and they actually see the church itself differently. The history of the church is the story of Catholic women in part, right? We're half the church. So,
yes.
And so I think that, you know, obviously church history developed out of the discipline of church history, grew out of theology. And so there's always been a kind of the anchor, the base of sources are theological writings and the decisions by popes and bishops. So that there's very natural reasons why men have had kind of the main spotlight on them. But as the discipline has grown and historians today speak of the history of Catholicism broadly, not just the history of the church institutionally, it's kind of opened up doors to scholars who are not Catholic in many cases, but are just fascinated by the story of Catholicism, to kind of show ways in which different actors than we're traditionally focused on were very much part of the story, and they help shed new light on some of the main iconic events. You know, you start to look at, say, church councils a little differently, like the call to be missionaries in Vatican II. Mother Teresa and other women missionaries were engage in some of the very things Vatican II calls for long before Vatican II, and we sort of help teach the church about what it meant to be a missionary before these statements come out about it by church authorities, right? So,
yeah.
Yeah,
and I do think as you do that, what you just described, it opens up possibilities in the imagination for the person, for the future as well. Like, if we forget these women, then we're going to forget that or maybe we're going to fall for the idea that it's only outside the church that a woman can come to her full potential.
Potential. Yeah. I mean, I go back to what I said in the intro of the book. I was raised Catholic and I never left the church. But there were moments when I was a younger woman that I felt like I didn't have enough role models who were female.
Yeah.
And it's not because they weren't there. It's because the stories that I was told did not include them in the same way. And so I want to help people avoid that same problem that I had to struggle with.
Then they can get the book, Women of the Church, What Every Catholic Should Know. Bronwen McShea has been our guest. It is her book. You can find her on Twitter or other social media, including, I'm told, the most boring social media, LinkedIn.
LinkedIn. That was I said that. Facebook.
Yeah, try all the usual social media. Dr. McShea, I'm very grateful for the book and that you were gracious enough to take the time to come and talk with us about it. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me on. I really appreciate it.
All right, Mark Brumley coming up. We'll do open forum with Mark Brumley. We'll also get his review of Dr. McShea's interview right after this, Catholic Answers Live. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live for the All Ignatius Press show today. First hour, author Bronwen McShea with a new book, Women of the Church, from Ignatius Press. And now the top dog, the big cheese, the Captain Kirk of the whole enterprise over there, Mark Brumley, president of Ignatius Press, for Open Forum. You're welcome to call 888-318-7884. He is the president of the most important publisher in the Alpha Quadrant. Hello, Mark Brumley.
Hey, how you doing, Si?
I'm doing very well. I have not... I was going to say, I haven't seen this view before. This is a new set. You have a lot of books behind you right now.
This is my home office. So
that's your home office?
That's my home office. Well, it's the back part of my home office.
Man, you must be so smart. That's a lot of books. That is a lot of
books. No, I need a lot of books because I'm not very smart. And there's a lot to learn.
Oh, okay. All right. You told us last time you were on, yes. I said, recommend a book. And you held up this book, Women of the Church, and you said what a fine book it was and that we should talk with Dr. Bronwen McShea, the author of it. And so we just did. The last hour we just spent with her.
Yeah.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, and of course, when I came on, we were talking before the show came on. When I came on, I could hear you and see you, but I couldn't hear or see her. And I thought, well, that's a perfect metaphor, you know.
Perfect metaphor. The man.
Talking to a woman about women in the church. You can't hear the woman. You only hear the man.
Yeah. That was just for you. On broadcast, people could hear both sides of the conversation.
Yeah.
And,
yeah,
that's it's always good for us to have, you know, she's a top-notch scholar. I mean, I was kind of teasing her when I met her before the show because, you know, it's like Harvard, Columbia. It's all the Ivy League schools and then a few other schools in there. And I was saying, oh, yeah, you and I have almost the same CV. It's almost exactly the same, except I didn't go to any of those schools. But it's just always impressive to meet someone who's just the real deal, you know, like a very careful.
Yeah, a real scholar.
A real scholar, yeah. But I think it's hard for them to be on the radio sometimes because they like to deal in, like, facts, and so if they don't know something, or you know, like so she was very careful, you know, she's scholarly, but what a great guest. Thanks for suggesting her to us.
It's great to have these historians on who like to deal in facts rather than like the two of us who are like whatever, you know?
That
sounds good.
My main source for my information is I heard it somewhere. That's my main, if I ever write a scholarly book, it's going to be, I heard it somewhere and then Ibid underneath it.
That's right.
That's
so before we get going, I got two things I have to mention. Is that okay?
Yeah. You can do anything. You're the top dog. You're the big cheese. You're the Captain Kirk.
So can you see up there? I'm pointing. People listening on the radio can't see it, but I'm pointing to two things up there.
Is one of those a Gorn?
You just said Captain Kirk. Yeah, one's a Gorn. That's this guy.
Yeah.
And there's a skull there. But then you recognize that guy there?
I can't make it out, Mark. I can't make it
out.
Well,
you should be able to infer who it is by virtue of the Gorn, but...
Oh, that it's Captain Kirk?
Here we go. Captain Kirk, stuffed animal there for
it's
the
a stuffed
radio listeners.
Animal Captain Kirk. Did you just put him up there, or is he always up there behind you, watching over you?
He's always up there. This is a gift from my daughter. So this is, you know. So I have Captain Kirk, and there's the little cannon he made to defeat the Gorn who's up there.
One of the best episodes, too. One of the best episodes. Yeah, teaching children
arena
how to make gunpowder.
Yeah, that's exactly right. It was actually, it was based on a short story. Anyway, I won't go into history.
Oh, it was
of that.
Based on a short story.
But the second thing I want to, that episode of Arena was based on a short story from Frederick Brown, and I think Gene Kuhn didn't exactly abscond with it, but he adapted it and realized, oh, wait a minute, maybe I got this concept from someplace, and so then they paid the guy. Yeah, they paid it him, which is his due, you know.
Yeah, but they stole every idea Ursula Le Guin ever had, and I don't think they ever paid her a penny. I mean, how many Star Trek episodes
I don't
are
know
you like?
They stole her ideas.
Well, maybe she stole them.
All right.
Again, it's not the facts that matter; it's the quality of the story.
Yes, and what makes for good radio.
Yeah,
so if it makes for good radio and it's
right.
not exactly true, well, okay. So then the other thing I want to mention is Bella Primary Care. is having a founder gala in San Francisco, and that's happening April 20th at the Irish Cultural Center in San Francisco. And this is, you know, for a truly pro-life primary care supporting organization that's being launched there. Archbishop Gordoleone is behind it, and other people, some of my friends, are involved with it. And it's really an answer to prayer, because it's a
praise
authentically
God.
Catholic healthcare clinic.
Is it kind of like
in San Francisco?
Well, we have the Culture of Life Family Services down here. Is it kind of like that kind of thing? They got the doctors and the nurses.
And it's Bella Founders, plural, Bella, B-E-L-L-A, Founders, Gala.com. People can find out more. Come out, whether you're in San Francisco, the larger Bay Area, or you live down in San Diego, drive up on Saturday, April 20th, and have a great cocktail hour and dinner at the Irish Cultural Center in San Francisco. There'll be an auction. There'll be dinner. There'll be music.
Corned beef and cabbage?
And the probably. proceeds from our gala are better. There are better foods than corned beef and cabbage. Proceeds will go to provide funding for uninsured patients. So
I feel like I'm the only
Catholic
person who
likes social action.
All right, let's do it. Check it out. What? Bella Founders. Just probably if you look up Bella Founders, you'll find it. But Bella Founders.
Foundersgala.com.
And I really do like corned beef and cabbage. Everyone thinks I'm joking when I say that.
I like it too.
I like
corned beef better than cabbage, but I like both.
Yeah, I see what you're saying. But you just need a little vinegar for that cabbage. 888-318-7884 is the number. 888-3. Did Brumley just leave? Does he not know we're in the middle of a show here?
He just left. I just left.
What
I
was
just
that?
Left.
All right, but I'm going to take calls.
I went to open the door to my office to let some fresh air in. That's all.
I'm glad. I thought the show was over for a second. Donna's in South Dakota listening on Real Presence Radio. And I got to say, twice I've gotten to be up with the folks in Real Presence Radio in North Dakota in the last 6 months. And both times, absolutely wonderful time. So, Donna, welcome.
Wow.
Can somebody push line one for me? I'm sorry. I was goofing around with Brumley. Donna, go ahead with your question.
Well, hi, good afternoon. Thank you for taking my call. This relates back to the previous guest speaker when she was talking about the women of the church. It got me to thinking about a couple of the books in the Bible, Esther, Judith, Ruth. Do we have any knowledge as to who might have written those books? Might they have been written by those women? Do we have any idea?
Mark?
We don't know for sure. We can start from the general premise that, on the whole, women generally didn't write in ancient, Hebraic or Jewish culture. There wasn't as much literacy as there is today. And among those who were literate and educated, they tended to be men. When women were educated, literate, there was a minority of women, already a minority of human beings who were. But that doesn't make it impossible. It's certainly possible. There's no reason why, in principle, women couldn't have been behind those books or written those books. But we don't have evidence that they did. It's obviously because they're about female characters, female people who experience things, women. So they certainly could be, and probably in most instances were, the source of the information in those books. But whether they actually wrote them, we don't know.
All right. Thank you.
Could I just add one thing and get your view on this, Mark? I believe.
Sure.
I believe the Virgin Mary wrote part of the Gospel of Luke, the part that says, my soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior, for God has looked with favor on the lowliness of the Almighty Servant. Didn't she write the Magnificat?
She is the source, obviously. She's the one who's praying the prayer and singing it.
Oh, but she might not have written it down.
Might not have written it down.
I see.
But it's very similar to material from the Old Testament, especially Hannah's song or whatever you want to call that. And no doubt Our Lady had that Old Testament song memorized and then adapted it. And that's quite probably why we have those words. I mean, they may not be the exact words that she prayed at, exactly that moment.
Oh, I see.
But why we are confident that the gist of it reflects what she actually prayed, because she probably adapted her prayer
from Hannah.
Yeah.
Okay. Donna, thank you. Thanks very much. We got to take a quick break. We'll be right back with more Open Forum with Mark Brumley right after this.
Stay with us for more Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Magnificat. Published monthly, Magnificat features texts of daily Mass, prayers, articles, meditations, art commentaries, and more, in step with the liturgical rhythm of the Church, on the web at Magnificat.com.
As the largest religious media network in the world, EWTN has an important role in educating others about our Catholic faith and spreading the good news of salvation. We invite you to explore our numerous pages of historical faith documents, prayers, teachings, and other current issues in Catholicism today. Visit EWTN.com and click Catholicism. EWTN is the global Catholic network.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live, the only show where in a span of just 2 or 3 minutes, discussion of the Gorn and of Our Lady's Prayer at the Annunciation. You're not going to get that anywhere else. I mean, you know, like Father Mitch Pack was good, but I don't think you're going to get much on the Gorn from him. I don't think you get a lot of Gorn stuff. Aiden is in Virginia watching on YouTube. Mark Brumley is our guest. Aiden, thank you for the call. Go ahead with your question for Mark.
Hi, thank you so much for taking my call. So I struggle with intrusive thoughts and scrupulosity, and I'm having a hard time with the unpardonable sin. So my question is, can the unpardonable sin be committed in thoughts, and is it possible for a person to lose the Holy Spirit?
So I would say yes, it's possible for the unforgivable sin or unpardonable sin to be committed in thought, and it is also possible for someone to lose sanctifying grace and the presence of the Holy Spirit in one's heart and mind through sanctifying grace, and that happens through grave sin. But I want to encourage you, and I know you're talking about struggling with scrupulosity, you can't sort of accidentally commit the unpardonable sin. And the fact that you are concerned about whether you may have done that or you're thinking about that possibility indicates that you haven't. Because the unpardonable sin is really final impenitence. So in a final definitive way, you are unrepentant of your sin, you know, your grave sin. And that's really the gist or the essence of the unpardonable sin, where you are actually rejecting, you know, deliberately rejecting the work of grace and the presence of the Holy Spirit in your life in that sense. So unless you've done that, you shouldn't be worried about the so-called unpardonable sin. And the fact that you're still here talking to me shows me that you haven't done that. You can still repent if you could, whatever sins you've committed. Does that help?
Yes. Thank you.
Yeah. And I know that it's easy for me to kind of glibly say all that when you're struggling with scrupulosity, but I do want to encourage you that if you're scrupulous about this point, the very fact that you are concerned about it shows that this is not something that you've done.
Aiden,
thank you so much.
If you'd like, I'd love to send you a little book we have from Jimmy Akin called The Words of Eternal Life, True Happiness and Where to Find It. If you would like the book, all you have to do is hang on the line, give an address to Edgar when he picks up, and we'll send it off to you. And call anytime. Thank you very much for the call. The number here is 888-318-7884. Going down to Charleston, South Carolina now, where Ryan is listening on 7:30 a.m. in Charleston. Ryan, thank you very much for the call. Mark Brumley is our guest. Go ahead with your question, please.
Hi, Mark. Hi, Si. Thanks for taking my call. My question is about the Divine Mercy chaplet. So I started reading the Diary of St. Faustina, and when I'm praying the chaplet, I have a hard time, you know, in my mind saying, okay, I want to forgive the whole world, like when there's some really bad sinners out there. And I was wondering how, I know Jesus wants everybody, you know, in heaven. And I need, like, sometimes I'm just like, okay, well, I want mercy for maybe the ignorant, the people who, no fault of their own, you know, they didn't join the Catholic faith or something like that. But I want, like, the people that are really bad sinners to be punished. And it's just, it's really hard for me to say the mercy for the whole world. And I was wondering if I could get some advice on that. On how to,
well, what,
you know, maybe.
Yeah. Go ahead.
So I don't know if you understand my question. But.
Sure. Sure I do. So what I would say is, I think all of us at times struggle with forgiving people who've harmed us. And then when we see horrible things people have done, we can struggle with being desirous of their salvation. And the fact that you may want to see justice done isn't a bad thing, because it's a way of affirming that what was done was really evil. And what it was, and it's really contrary to God's will and God's goodness and God's justice. So recognizing when somebody has done something gravely evil and wanting to see that, in a certain sense, encounter justice is a good thing in itself. But God tells us that what he wants is that he wants everybody to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. He wants everybody to repent. He wants everybody to be reconciled with him. And so we start from that premise and we say that even the most terrible sinner, it's God's will, whatever it is, whatever is going on in our minds and hearts, it's God's will that that person, that he wants that person to be repentant, to be saved. And so then I have to deal with my feelings and I have to decide whether I'm going to let my feelings or my perception overrule God's will, or I'm going to align myself with what God wants for that person. The thing that helps me is when I meditate deeply on my own sins and I become aware that I've done very bad things. I haven't killed anybody or done anything like that, but the seeds of that kind of evil that you see in murder or rape or you know, grand theft auto or whatever, the seeds of those kinds of things are in our hearts, even in the lesser sins, and all those lesser sins can still be gravely sinful. Those seeds are there. And when I examine myself, my conscience very carefully, I recognize that. And I see, if I'm putting myself in the proper mindset, I see the ugliness of my sin, how ugly it must be from God's perspective, how wrong what I've done must be from his perspective. And I realize, well, I want mercy and forgiveness, so I should be willing to extend mercy and forgiveness to others, which is what God wants for them. So if I am repentant of my sin and I am looking for, and I am expressing divine charity, love of God above all things for his own sake, and love of a neighbor as self, that means I'm going to will the good of these other people, and I'm going to want forgiveness for them, even as I ask for forgiveness for myself. Now, I may not always feel that way. It may not be the impulse or the inclination of my heart, but, you know, doing the right thing is more than our feelings. Feelings follow our faith. Feelings often have to follow the facts, the truth. Oftentimes we feel things that are contrary to the truth, and we have to work our way through it and believe what God has said and trust in the truth of God to eventually help our feelings conform to that. So that's what I would say when we're praying divine mercy prayers or any other kind of prayers that involve God's forgiveness for other people, that we keep in mind the fact that we are ourselves sinners in need of forgiveness. God is merciful. God desires to forgive them. We need to align what we will and what we choose to will for others to correspond with what God wants, and then our feelings will eventually conform to that.
Ryan?
Yeah, thank you. No, that was very clear and helpful. Thank you, Mark.
Oh, great, Ryan.
All right.
Thank you very much for the call. The number here is 888-318-7884. Mark Brumley is our guest, and it's open forum this hour. If you have a question for Mark about the Catholic faith, whether you're Catholic or not, whether you agree with what we say here about the Catholic faith, or whether some of it gives you trouble and you'd like to have a dialogue about it, whatever your the case is, you are welcome to call 888-318-7884. Mary's in Fort Worth, Texas, listening on the Guadalupe Radio Network. Mary, welcome. Go ahead with your question for Mark.
Hey there. I just wanted to ask, what is the difference between a holy day of obligation and a solemnity?
Okay, well, very good question. Well, solemnity is a high form of holy day or sacred day in the observance of the church. Church's liturgical life and the church's general pastoral spiritual life. Holy days of obligation are a subset of that. So there are days that are especially set aside by the church, where the church obliges by the power of Christ. Christ has given the church and leadership of his community of followers. Holy days of obligation are days that the church obliges us to participate in the sacred liturgy by attending Holy Mass. So that's a subset, smaller set, of the larger group of holy days that we call solemnities. So, for example, the Feast of St. Luke is a solemnity, but it is not a holy day of obligation. So that shows how it's a larger feast day, but the category of solemnities, a larger category, includes more holy days of obligation. Adding those words obligation indicate that it's a subset, and these are the days the church has said that we have to observe. It's a principal feast day that we have to observe, as we do observe going to Mass on Sunday. So how's that? That makes sense?
It does. Thank you so much.
All right, Mary. Thank you very much. I think we've got a couple minutes here before we have to go to the break. The number is 888-318-7884, but I'm going to go to a YouTube question, which we have not done in a while, and I apologize for that. This comes from Christine on YouTube. What are the different levels of hell, and why? Thank you.
Well, we don't know a whole lot about that. Of course, Dante, in the Divine Comedy, the portion of the Divine Comedy called the Inferno, has the various circles of hell. And that's an artistic creation. It's not as if Dante is saying that he has special revelation to tell us the exact nature of damnation and the various nine circles of hell and so on. But what I would say is there is reason to suppose that damnation would have two facets to it. One would be a sort of what is common to all those who are damned, namely the exclusion of the vision of God and whatever kinds of suffering result from that on that point. And then a measure of proportionality between what one has done that's wrong and ways that one has rejected God and the punishment that one receives. And so in the scriptures, for example, Jesus, I forget the exact reference in the Bible, but he talks about the servant that does really bad things, getting really punished really badly, getting beaten, as the image that he uses, and the servant, the servant who did his master's will and knew his master's will and just didn't do it, gets severely punished. The one who didn't quite know what his master's will was, but he did something wrong and he kind of knew it was wrong, but he didn't quite know how it fit in with his master's will, he will be punished too because he did something that's wrong, but he will receive fewer lashes. Now, of course, that's an image. Can't take that literally, but it conveys the idea that there's a kind of proportionality when it comes to consequence or punishment for sin that corresponds to the gravity of what we did. Anybody who would be damned would have committed grave sin, but some grave sins are worse than others. So that's the idea. We don't, beyond that, we don't, can't say too much. Obviously, we don't want people to go to hell. We pray that they don't, but it's pretty clear from Scripture and from the tradition of the church that people who, you know, commit grave sin and die in that state and are unrepentant, they're cut off from God by their choice. And therefore, we will say that there are degrees of that being cut off, just as we'll say there are degrees of heaven. Beyond that, we can't say too much. We're in speculative realm.
Christine, thank you for the question. Glad we got one from YouTube, and we haven't done that for a while. There's a couple lines open, 888-318-7884. Mark Brumley is our guest, back with more questions on Open Forum on Catholic Answers Live. This year, the Catholic Answers Conference turns to the parables, sermons, and conversations of Jesus Christ. Join special guests Scott and Kimberly Hahn, Dr. Ray Guarendi, and an all-star lineup of speakers September 26th through 29th. Spend time with your favorite Catholic Answers apologists and our special guests right here in beautiful San Diego. Seats are still available, but going fast. Use promo code EARLY to save $50 and register today at CatholicAnswersConference.com.
When it comes to Catholic teachings about Mary, there's one question we hear more than any other. Where is that in the Bible? The answer? Everywhere. In Bible Mary, the Mother of Jesus and the Word of God, Father John Weiss opens Scripture to reveal a Mary who has been hiding in plain sight. Order your copy of Bible Mary today at shop.catholic.com or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
When the resurrected Jesus appeared to disciples on the road to Emmaus, they didn't recognize him until the breaking of the bread. The same is true today. In the Holy Eucharist, we really meet Jesus. In The Eucharist is Really Jesus, author Joe Heschmeyer explains how knowing Jesus in the Eucharist is the key to understanding all of Christian faith. Order your copy of The Eucharist is Really Jesus today at shop.catholic.com or get it at a good Catholic bookstore.
If you're not a Bible scholar, the full message of how the Sunday Mass readings fit together can be tough to comprehend. Apologist Carlo Broussard is here to help. Join Carlo every Friday for the Sunday Catholic Word Podcast. In each episode, he unpacks the scripture readings for that Sunday and brings them all together so you can better understand and defend the faith. Visit SundayCatholicWord.com to subscribe. That's SundayCatholicWord.com.
Conversation about God's truth along with guests and your calls. I'm Deacon Harold Burke-Sivers, and I invite you to join me tomorrow for Beacon of Truth on most of these EWTN stations. Now back to Catholic Answers Live with Cy Kellett.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. Mark Brumley is our guest. Mark is president of Ignatius Press. You should check out all that they do at Ignatius.com, and they do lots of wonderful stuff, books and videos. And if it's media, they probably make it. And it's very, very Catholic and very, very helpful. Ignatius.com. We still want you to come on the Catholic Answers Cruise with us, and I'm more motivated than ever because I got a free box of cookies on the line. Chris Check told me, he thought he needed to motivate me to talk about the cruise. So he goes, if you get 13 more people, I'll give you a box of cookies. That was what he said to me. And I was deeply insulted by that. And I thought, well, I'm definitely talking about the cruise more. You can come on the cruise with us. It's June 29th. I mean, I was offended, but I'm not stupid. I want the cookies. June 29th to January 6th, we leave from Montreal. We go through Quebec. We'll see the St. Anne de Beaupré Church. All kinds of wonderful things. Nova Scotia, where I think it's Pippi Longstocking comes from. Where we're, I think, no, I'm serious. I think she comes from I think she's Nova Scotia. All right, moving on. We'll go to Baja, Maine. We'll go to Boston, and we'd love it if you'd come. Just go to CatholicAnswersCruise.com. Help me get those cookies. CatholicAnswersCruise.com. Mark, you're very literary. I can tell by the giant pile of books behind you. Pippi Longstocking, isn't she from Nova Scotia, or is that Anne of Green Gables? Do I get the two confused? I think it might
Anne of Green Gables is from Prince Edward Island. I, 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 I oh, don't yeah.
That's
I don't know about Pippi Longstocking. So
yeah, no, I think it's Anne of Green Gables. I was thinking of. Doggone it, are they two different people? I don't know. It's like Bilbo and Frodo.
They are.
Are they the same person or are they two different people? Zachary's in New York. Oh, New York City. New York City. Listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Zachary, we're awful glad you're here. Go ahead with your question for Mark.
Hey, thank you guys for taking my call. So my question is, one of the most convincing proofs I've heard against Eastern Orthodoxy has been the idea that they have the inability to hold ecumenical councils after the schism. And recently I was learning about the Synod of Jerusalem of 1672 and that it was fully accepted by the Eastern Orthodox churches. And so I assume all these Catholic apologists have not simply missed this council in their research. So I was wondering if there's something I'm missing here, what you guys have to say about that.
Well, I just say I don't really put a lot of weight in the argument that somehow Eastern Orthodoxy that an argument against Eastern Orthodoxy is that they haven't had an ecumenical council. I will say, well, if you believe that in order for a council to be ecumenical, its conduct has to at least been retroactively approved by the Bishop of Rome, then of course it will not be possible for Eastern Orthodox churches that don't recognize the authority, by definition, don't recognize the authority of Bishop Rome to have ecumenical council. So that would certainly be the case. But if that means that Eastern Orthodoxy can't be the most rightly ordered expression of Christ Church in the world because they themselves don't see themselves as being able to speak for the Church of Christ by having a council that they would regard as ecumenical. I don't think that's true. I think that they would say that could happen. So I don't find that argument especially strong or weighty from a Catholic point of view. So that's what I would say.
Okay, Zachary?
Yeah, no, that's fair enough. It makes sense. Thank you.
All right. Mark does. Sometimes he makes good sense. 888-318-7884 is the number. They were both redheaded orphans. That's what made... Oh, now you're putting Captain Kirk in front of the camera. Mark, people expect maturity from the president of Ignatius Press.
You are right? Talking about what Pippi Longstockings and Anne of Green Gables have in common.
They're redheaded
you're
orphans.
Me because I got it. Yeah, and you're saying that they expect more maturity.
I'm a lowly radio host. You're the president of one of America's most important publishing houses. Are you comparing? Okay. That's the standards are not the same at all. Daniel.
I stand corrected.
You look so sad now. Daniel in Grapevine, Texas, listening on the Guadalupe Radio Network. Thank you for the call. Daniel, go ahead with your question for Mark.
Hello, can you hear me?
Very well, yes, thank you.
Yes.
Okay. So my question is about organ transplantation.
Okay.
So I am 31, but when I was 22, I had a bilateral lung transplant, meaning two lungs at the same time from a deceased donor. And I'm just wondering what the official church teaching on organ transplantation is, and also, how will my glorified body, God willing, I make it to heaven, be different, and how will it relate to that of my donor? I know that's kind of
so. With respect, those are good questions.
Clear answer.
Those are fun questions, though. What do you think, Si? Do you think those are fun questions?
I do think they are fun questions. I have a feeling the answers are going to be equally fun. Let's hear.
Well, with respect to the church's teaching on organ transplants and donations, that this is morally allowed as long as you don't kill the person that you're taking the organ from, you know.
Well, that's
that kind of thing.
Yeah, there are some countries where that does seem to be the practice, which is
that's right.
Yeah.
And so that would be wrong, not because it's an organ transplant, but because you would be killing somebody. So the church has not just the church, but most people's ethical systems would say, no, you can't kill people to give their organs to somebody else. But we live in an age where all kinds of things happen. Anyway, that's that. But with respect to the connection, the organ that you receive and the organ donor in heaven and so on, I think that obviously there's some measure of continuity between our embodiedness now, that is to say, our having bodies now, and our embodiedness in heaven. St. Paul talks about it. You know, he talks about, he uses the image of a perishable seed, an imperishable resurrected body in the age to come, and so on. So there's some measure of continuity or linkage, but neither scripture nor tradition has fully, at least according to the church's teaching at this stage of things, fully expanded on that and helped us understand that in its totality. So we don't exactly know. We know that in the age to come, our glorified body, resurrected bodies, will not suffer the limitations of due to death and sin and things of that sort in this life. They'll be like the resurrected body of our Lord. They'll be glorified. They'll be eternal. We'll have these unique characteristics that we see that Jesus had when he appeared in resurrected form and so on. There'll be some link between us now as we are now and us as we will be then, not simply that we'll be the same person, in that sense our souls will be the same, but some kind of link to our embodiedness now, whether that means, you know, a perfectly wonderful 32-year-old handsome Mark Brumley. I remember when I was 32. I don't know how
you
handsome
don't.
I was, but
you don't remember that.
I was working at Catholic Answers at the time. But the exact nature of that is not clear. And so what would be the exact relationship between an organ donor and a recipient of that organ in the age to come? Well, I don't think we'll be sharing glorified donated organs, but I do think there'll be a special relationship of charity, because that gift of the organ enabled someone to live. Someone's life to thrive. And so therefore that's an expression of charity and God's goodness and generosity. And so I think that will perhaps be reflected and carried over somehow in the age to come. But beyond that, I don't think we could say too much.
Daniel, what do you think?
Yeah, that was a great answer. Thank you for that.
Are you well now?
Oh yeah, I'm doing fantastic.
Oh, I'm glad to hear it. I'm glad to hear it.
Excellent.
In June will be 9 years, but for my 10-year, I'm going to throw a huge party for sure.
Very, very good. Have you completed the guest list? Because I would be happy to give you some free books or anything that would maybe convince you to send me an invite.
Oh, I don't think I've considered that yet.
All right. But I would like to send you something. If you'd like something that Catholic Answers publishes, one of our books, we'd be happy to send it to you. Just tell Edgar. He'll pick up the line, and you can tell him which of our books by Trent Horn or Jimmy Akin or Tim Staples, Joe Heschmeyer, Carlo, or anybody that writes for Catholic Answers, but including Mark Brumley, who wrote The Seven Deadly Sins of Apologetics. On we go. Oh, no, not on we go. I got to take a quick break. Right back with more Open Forum with Mark Brumley on Catholic Answers Live.
You're listening to Catholic Answers Live. Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
You know, we talk story with each of our very unique guests for the whole hour so that you can go deep with us as you yourself pursue your own story of heroic virtue and as you pursue intimacy with God.
The Bear Wozniak Adventure, Saturday night, 6 Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Who was the first Catholic in your family? Were they evangelized by a friend, a coworker, a stranger? Did you ever think that you could be that person that God uses to save a soul and that soul could save their family, their grandchildren, and generations to come. At St. Paul Street Evangelization, a Catholic nonprofit, we train, equip, and mobilize Catholic disciples to do the urgent work of evangelization. Catholic Answers is supported in part by St. Paul Street Evangelization, streetevangelization.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. Mark Brumley is our guest. I'm going to go quick now because all of a sudden all the line's full. Everybody wants to talk with Mark, and so we'll go to Birmingham, Alabama, where Michael is listening on Catholic.com. Welcome, Michael. Go ahead with your question for Mark.
Hi, Mark. Thank you for taking my question here. So I'm currently still getting into apologetics and trying to, you know, figure out how to defend my faith. But I was talking with a Protestant, and we had a great two-hour conversation. And his approach to the church is that, you know, the church is not necessary for salvation, that through Christ alone you can attain salvation. And he began, you know, naming off different passages throughout Scripture where Jesus says, you know, John 3:16 was one of the ones that I just off the top of my head that he mentioned. And so I, you know, pointed him back to Acts 2:42 and, you know, the teachings of the apostles and the fellowship. And he kept going back to, well, like, you know, it doesn't say you need a church for salvation. It doesn't say you need to go to church on Sundays. It doesn't say all of these things. And I kind of got stumped a little bit and couldn't really think of any more verses to point back towards why you do need a church for salvation. And so, yeah, I'm not sure maybe if you can point me in the direction so that way when I meet back up with him, I can maybe help him to answer those answer some of those questions a little bit better.
All right. Thank you, Michael.
Of course, we need Jesus for salvation, and we encounter Jesus through the church. So we get to get things in right order. It's not like the church saves us. Jesus saves us, and in saving us, he makes us part of this church. So how does that come about that Jesus saves us? Well, obviously, faith is involved, and where do we... How do we have faith in Jesus? We have faith by hearing the word of God and believing it, right? Receiving it by grace, certainly always by grace, but it's the word of God. Well, where do we get the word of God from? When you say we get it from Scripture. What? But where did we get Scripture from? Didn't fall out of the sky. It was divinely inspired, so God gave it to us. Yes, yes, he did. How did he give it to us? He gave it to us through the church, because Church of the Old Testament gave us the Old Testament, Church of the New Testament. The biblical writers wrote the Gospels. St. Paul wrote his epistles. The other New Testament writers wrote their contributions. They were churchmen. They were writing to and for the church. Under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, to be sure. But nevertheless, they were doing things as churchmen for the church. And then, of course, how do we get the canon of the Bible? Well, it's by churchmen, by bishops. Catholic bishops who settled the question dispute among the followers of Jesus, what makes up the canon of the Bible? What does Jesus say regarding being his follower? He talks, you got to be baptized, right? That's what he says in Mark's gospel. Who believes and is baptized shall be saved. He who does not believe will not be, right? Okay, so baptism, you know, Jesus tells Nicodemus, must be born from above. What does Peter say? Acts 2:38, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, right? So it's clear that the baptism is part of what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ. Have you been baptized? Well, you can't baptize yourself, and Jesus makes clear that he sent his disciples to baptize other people. So you need the church for baptism. What about Eucharist? Lest ye eat my flesh and drink my blood, ye have not life within you. Whether you believe the Eucharist is what Jesus says it is, which is his body and blood, nevertheless you see that the Eucharist is an important thing. Jesus commanded at the Last Supper that the Eucharist be done in commemoration of him. Well, you can't just be by yourself celebrating the Eucharist. We see that. How was the Eucharist celebrated in the early church? It was celebrated in a community. So you want to be obedient to what the early church did, what the New Testament shows. You see. It's celebrated in community, that is to say, as part of the church. We could go through passage after passage, indication after indication. Jesus says that the community of his followers, that is to say, those people who have been saved, is founded on the rock of Peter. So it's clear that there is an authority, an apostolic authority. Even if you don't believe that apostolic authority continues now down in the form of the Pope, it's clear that there is a church community that Jesus expects his followers to be part of, and not lone Christians on their own. So I'm going to stop here for a moment and see what you think about that.
Yeah, no. I think that's a really, really good, great approach. Very, very similar to my approach when I was, bringing that up to him. But I didn't bring up necessarily, baptism. So that's, something I would love to bring up, or even the Eucharist for that sake. But yeah, I definitely think that approach to, needing these things for salvation, and you need a church for these things. And that salvation, I mean, we see it throughout Scripture. It is by faith, but yeah, Jesus points to these things like baptism, like the Eucharist, that are required by a church. That's So yeah, I think that's a really, really good approach.
All right. I'm going to leave it there.
Yeah, and I think what might be happening. Oh, okay.
No, go ahead. That's fine.
I was just going to say that sometimes we can miss the forest for the trees. I'm trying to look for a particular verse that says all these things, instead of just looking at the wider context, which is being a disciple of Jesus means being part of his church. And the idea that somehow you can be a disciple of Jesus without being part of his church is absurd. That doesn't, nowhere in the Bible is that envisioned.
Okay, and I will leave that there. Michael, thank you. I'm going to try to get as many on as I can with Mark. And we'll go to Mike in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, watching on Facebook. Mike, welcome. Go ahead with your question for Mark.
Good evening. My question is about the Tyndale Bible. I'm also attempting to have a charitable conversation with a Protestant sister in Christ who today threw an interesting one at me, claiming that Catholic bishops strangled and burned the body of William Tyndale for the sole reason of attempting to have the Bible translated into English. When I sent her what I could cobble together online, she replied that it was a bunch of Roman Catholic rationalization hooey. And I thought, well, let me call Catholic Answers and see if I can get a few more resources in order to re-engage our sister in Christ here.
So you want to know why William Tyndale was killed?
Yeah, I think the main point is that she and her Protestant church are putting forth that the Catholics basically killed Tyndale for just attempting to have the Bible merely translated into English, and I think there's a little bit more to it than that.
Oh yeah, okay.
Right. So that's false. That wasn't why Tyndale was executed. Context: Catholics and Protestants in the 16th century often arrested one another for heresy and did terrible things, and that was bad. Those were bad things. They looked at things differently. They were right to affirm the importance of being orthodox and being faithful to the gospel. They were wrong about, and they rightly understood that there can be great harm to Christian societies when false teachings are spread around. But the particular way they sought to address that, which was to use things like capital punishment, was, in my view, and I think it's the view of Pope John Paul II, Benedict XVI, and Francis, and the Second Vatican Council, and a lot of other Catholic leaders, that the way they went about safeguarding the truths of the faith by executing people and things of that sort was not good. Was not wise or prudent or charitable or whatever. So that happened with William Tyndale. He was arrested for and found guilty of heresy, basically holding Lutheran views, and he was put to death for that. He was not put to death for translating the Bible. Translating the Bible was not illegal. There were and had been English translations of the Bible before Tyndale's time. There was nothing wrong or sinful or inappropriate about translating the Bible as such. Now, oftentimes the church was very wary of efforts to translate the Bible because the particular translators were trying to reflect their own false ideas about what the Bible means in how they translated. So the church was very cautious not to have bad translations, but the mere act of translating the Bible is not sinful, and translating it to English was not sinful, and therefore that would not be in it simply by itself a reason why Tyndale would have been executed. And it wasn't, in fact, the reason. That help,
Mike?
No, thank you. That really helps. I'll re-engage and hopefully change some minds and hearts. I appreciate your time.
Right. And one additional element here, you can go to, in fact, you might want to cite secular sources, because this is not a point of controversy among, like, ordinary, as I was saying earlier with respect to Bronwen McShea, bona fide historians. You know,
sure.
Real historians are not going to say, you know, that give you some other explanation for why Tyndale was executed.
No, it's quite an extraordinary story, actually. He's given years to recant or to be convinced of the Catholic position. I'm not saying he should have been killed, but it's not a story like, right. Oh, this guy translated. That's not, he was never charged with translation of the Bible, and he was, and the efforts to make a conversion rather than an execution were quite extensive. That being said, Mark is correct about all that, about we shouldn't have been killing each other. Sherry's in Oklahoma listening on Catholic.com. Sherry, go ahead with your question for Mark.
Thank you for taking my call.
Happy to, Sherry.
Oh, thank you. Well, you may not be saying that after you talk to me.
Oh, it's going to be one of those. All right, go ahead.
Yeah, sorry. Okay, well, I've come back to the Catholic faith, and I've just been immersing myself in everything that the church has to offer me to help learn about my faith and to just love Jesus more through my faith. And I grew up with the blessing of persons, you know, going in the communion line who are not receiving the Eucharist. I grew up with that custom in my early teens. And I accepted the reason that was given to me at the time, because it was the purpose, or the reason I was told was that it was that to make all persons feel welcome, and that so no one would feel embarrassed by not being able to go up in the line with the other people.
Okay.
But you fast forward decades later, and I used to be an educator, so I'm very in tune to the process of forming a hypothesis or learning objective and then observing and evaluating the data, you know, the effects of it. And so the church's three roles are to teach, to govern, and to sanctify. And as this custom has continued in a lot of the parishes, and I find no evidence to support justifying the inclusion of something that is an innovation. You know, it's outside the rubrics of the Mass. It's not,
okay.
And it's only opened the door to, like, confusion and disobedience, and even it's introduced scandal. You know, because if you think about...
Sherry, I'm sorry. I got to let Mark... Because he's only got 30 seconds left.
Sorry. Okay.
That's okay.
Are there any other reasons given for this innovation? That would be probably...
Okay, Mark?
If I could sum it up.
I think that people seeking blessings, generally, that's a good thing. If they're seeking blessings on something that's sinful, that's a bad thing. But just the seeking of blessing and asking for God's blessing is not a bad thing, but a good thing. And if for whatever reason they're not disposed to receive the Eucharist, I don't have an objection to them seeking a blessing. And I understand the point about we don't want to have all these innovations in the liturgy, but the idea that someone is seeking a blessing who can't receive the Eucharist at that particular time, I don't see that as a problematic innovation. Lots of innovations in the church, not all of them are problematic. Some of them are good, and this would seem to me to be a good one.
Sherry, I'm sorry that we couldn't have a longer conversation, but welcome home to the Catholic faith. And if you'd like, I'd like to send you a copy of Joe Heschmeyer's book, The Early Church Was the Catholic Church. And I just think you'll enjoy it. It's a lovely book. Mark Brumley, president of Catholic Answers. I'm sorry I didn't leave you very much time on that last one, Mark, but thank you for the hour.
Wow. I've become president of Catholic Answers. I love
it. I meant Ignatius Press. Oh, I apologize. No, you're not my boss.